Hello and welcome. Today I'm going to share a brief overview of my top 10 Google Classroom tips for creating an efficient, organized, and powerful learning environment for your students. Feel free to visit the comment section to view the timestamps and skip to the tips that interest you the most. My name is Misty Treviño. I am a digital learning consultant at Region 10 Education Service Center. Let's start by exploring ways we can ensure that we are maximizing the efficiency of our digital workspace. Google Classroom is set up to provide email notifications for specific activity in Google Classroom. Its default mode is set to where all notifications are on. To avoid being flooded with email notifications from your Google Classroom account, click the main menu icon and settings. Here, you can turn on or off email notifications for each individual class. For the classes that you would like to receive email notifications for, you can choose which email notifications you would like to receive. You can also very easily turn on and off email notifications for all classes as well. Another way to maximize the efficiency and enhance the organizational structure of your digital workspace is to adjust the settings for each individual class. In each class, click on the gear icon in the top right corner to adjust the class settings. In another video, I do a step-by-step walkthrough on each of the settings, but today I just want to highlight one feature in particular, and that is the stream setting. Each class's default setting is set to where all classwork is shown on the stream. In my experience, because students enter through the stream, they tend to look for assignments here. And as you can see, if we don't hide the notifications, this area tends to become very cluttered, and students spend a lot of time searching through this page to find what they're looking for. My suggestion would be to hide all classwork notifications from the stream and also change your student comment permissions to either students can only comment or teachers can post or comment on the stream until you have your classroom expectations established. Once you've done that, click save. When we hide those classwork notifications from the stream, students are met with a much cleaner view and they are forced to go to the classwork page to view their assignments, which will prevent them from searching in multiple places, making this space easier to navigate and much more efficient. That brings me to tip number three, creating an organizational system for your classwork page. I have three tips to maximize and enhance the use of this space. First, build a shell of your classwork page structure. The best way to do this is to create topics that assignments will fall under. You're basically grouping the content you teach by either units, weeks, dates, or anything else that fits with the way and order in which you present content to your learners. You can see here that I've organized my classwork structure into units. I created the shell for my classwork structure, so on my end, I can see the three topics I've created, but when students access their classwork page, they will only be able to see unit one because I have not yet posted anything under units two and three. Next is to create assignments using a naming convention and then place those assignments underneath the topic. I usually start with the unit, the assignment in that unit. So this is unit one, assignment number five, the title of the assignment, and the date that I assigned it. I also add the day of the week. I add my assignment instructions, and then I click on topic to add my unit one topic. Creating a naming convention for your assignments is very helpful when or if you reuse assignments. If I go to create and reuse post, I may have tons of posts available for me to reuse, so the numbering convention helps me quickly find the assignments I'm looking for. Last, I'm a very visual learner, so I love to add emojis wherever possible. I usually add emojis to my topics. If you look under all topics in the left panel, students can see a visual representation of the work that we are doing. I like to use emojis for my assignments as well. I tend to keep the same emojis for specific assignments, such as the thought cloud for brainstorming activities and the speech bubble for discussion activities. One of my favorite ways to add emojis to Google Classroom is with the Emoji Keyboard by JoyPixel's Chrome extension. Visit the Chrome Web Store, search for Emoji Keyboard by JoyPixel's, and add that to Chrome. Once you've added to Chrome, click the extension, and here you can browse emojis by category, via search, or just scroll through their catalog of emojis. Click on an emoji you would like to use. JoyPixels will copy that emoji to your keyboard, which will allow you to paste it in the desired location in Google Classroom. Tip number four is to create a topic titled Class Info and Materials. You can create and add materials such as your class syllabus and add that to your class information plus materials topic. I like to create material and put them under a topic that is always at the top of our classwork page in Google Classroom because I am able to rearrange what is under that topic. When you create material and you don't post it to a particular topic, it will pin the material to the top of your classwork page, but you are not able to rearrange the tiles. I found that I much prefer to add material to a topic versus adding material that I don't assign to a topic so that I can rearrange the materials as needed. For tip number five, I suggest getting familiar with the different assignment types in Google Classroom. I have created a Google Classroom series, and all of my assignment videos provide detailed information on the ins and outs of each of these different assignment types, and even what each assignment type looks like from the student view in Google Classroom. I cover assignments where students might all be working on one document together, assignments that involve offline learning activities or maybe station rotation activities, assignments where students will be individually working with a digital document or digital manipulatives, the best way to create a classroom discussion, a super fast and easy way to create a self-grading quiz, and even assignments where students may have choice in what they create. Please watch the assignment videos in this series to learn more about various assignment types and what they look like from the teacher and student perspective. Tip number six is to provide clear and concise assignment instructions. Keep instructions brief. Utilize the built-in rich text formatting, such as bulleted lists, and add visual cues to help students break down and process the information you provide. With that being said, you are not able to provide these types of clear and concise instructions if you don't know what the assignment looks like from the student perspective. For example, I created a question, and on my end, this is what I see. When I save the assignment and click View Question, this is my view, but when students view the question, this is the screen that they see. They type their answer here, click the turn in button, and then click to see classmates' responses. I would not be able to provide these type of clear and concise instructions if I was not able to view this from the student perspective. That leads me to tip number seven. Unfortunately, Google Classroom does not make it easy for us to view work from the student's perspective, but there are a couple of things that we can do. First, try contacting your Google administrator to see if they are able to create a student demo account for you to use. This may not always be possible, but it would probably be the easiest way to view assignments you post from a student perspective. If they are able to create you a demo account, you would click on your Chrome profile, add that account to Chrome, and from there, you can very easily switch in between accounts. You can even create a split screen view to see what your teacher account looks like in comparison to your student demo account. If that's not an option for you, you can ask a fellow coworker or team member to join your class as a student. This option may not always be ideal because you will need to view the assignments from their device, but it is an option. Third, whenever you post an assignment, you can always ask a student to show you what their view looks like and adjust your instructions as needed. Last, once you get familiar with the different assignment types, create a Google Classroom assignment type cheat sheet. That way, whenever you create an assignment type, like maybe a question, you have those assignment turn-in instructions ready. You can easily copy and paste those very quickly into the instructions field without having to flip back and forth from a teacher to student view. Create a custom banner for your Google Classroom using Canva. Canva for Education is free for all K through 12 educators. With it, you get all the benefits of premium features such as millions of images, fonts, graphics, videos, animations, and templates, as well as a dedicated classroom space to invite students and teachers to share, review, and manage your work. Visit www.canva.com/education to sign up for your Canva education account. Once in your Canva account, search for Google Classroom Banner. From here, you can browse through hundreds of pre-made banner templates. If you'd like to create a custom design, click Create a Design, Custom Size, enter in 1600 by 400 pixels as the dimensions, and create New Design. From here, you'll use the design panel and menu to adjust your design. For this video, I'm going to use a pre-made template. I scroll down a bit to find this template. Notice that there is a play button in the bottom right corner. That is telling me that this is an animated design. I'm going to click to choose this design, and it immediately transfers over to my canvas. A couple of tips for designing your banners for Google Classroom. One, your class name and information appears on the left side of the banner once you upload it to your page. So anything on the far left side of your design will probably be covered. To make sure your entire design is visible, click your text, click and hold shift while clicking on your other elements to select them all. You can see that they are all selected. Click and drag the top corner to resize and adjust as needed. Second, any custom banners uploaded to Google Classroom appear a lot darker. So that is something to keep in mind when designing. When you are ready to download, click download. If you didn't want this image animated, you would choose PNG. I do want this particular image animated, so I'm going to click GIF and click download. From my Google Classroom, click upload photo, choose the photo from my device, and adjust the size. And just like that, you've added a little pizzazz to your digital space. Use Flipgrid to enhance the lessons you post to Google Classroom, or maybe even your assignment instructions. Go to Flipgrid and log into your account. Then click Shorts. Shorts allows you to use the power of the Flipgrid camera to record videos, capture your screen, and easily share your ideas with anyone at any time. To create a new short, click on the Short button. For this video, I'm going to show you how to record your screen while you talk students through a lesson or instructions. Click Backdrop, then the computer icon. I'm going to choose Chrome tab because I have my Google Classroom open in another tab. Click Share, go back to your Flipgrid tab. Here, I'm going to move myself to the left, hit Record, and then I'm going to click on the Google Classroom tab and record as I would. When I'm done, I'm going to go back to my Flipgrid tab, explore all of the amazing tools I can use to enhance my video even more, click Next, then next again, and then confirm to process and upload. From here, I can click the Google Classroom icon and share directly to my class as part of my assignment. So amazing. Tip number 10 is to have students bookmark their Google Classroom for easy access. To do that, they are going to go to their Google Classroom landing page, click the star in the Omni box. From here, they can leave the name as it is, edit it, or delete it altogether. They'll want to make sure that it's saved to the bookmarks bar folder and then click done. You can see that it's added the icon as well as the text here to the bookmarks bar. If they only want the icon to appear, they'll click the star in the Omni box to edit the bookmark title and then delete the text. That will leave just the icon on the bookmarks bar, which is a great way to maximize their bookmarks bar space. The next time students log into their Google account, all they'll need to do is click on the icon to be taken directly to their Google Classroom. Thanks for spending some time with me today. If you would like to earn CPE credit for watching this video, enroll in the micro learning courses linked below. Check out all of the videos in our Google Classroom series, and don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Bye.